leaders to be better leaders in difficult times. May your name be glorified. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The presentation is at the middle of the booklet, the center page, page 38. And the title of this presentation is Christian Leadership Amidst Difficulties of Life, Looking Unto Jesus. Actually, the purpose of this presentation is to encourage Christian leaders. Whether you are a Sunday school teacher, whether you are a deacon in the church, whether you are a financial officer, whether you are a women leader, men leader, whether you are a pastor, in whatever capacity you are leading God's people in the church, and you are facing personal challenges in your own life. And like the question our brother asked, that question actually means so much to me. It went so deep in my heart. And I believe that that question, it arose from the inmost heart of our brother. And that would be the kind of question that so many Christian leaders are asking. So many pastors are asking. Genuinely, you are faithful. There's a passage in the Bible that sent me thinking and praying as a pastor. A woman came to the head of the prophets and he said, "You know my husband very well, that my husband was a faithful priest. My husband was faithful and he had died. And after his death, he left debts. He was a debtor when he died. And now those creditors have come to take my two sons as their slaves in place of the debt that my husband was owing." I was in pain in my heart when I was reading that. And so many Christian leaders, they are in such situation. Faithful, committed, whereas there are issues of life. Existential issues of life. And sometimes those issues, they try to choke our commitment. There are times when you sit down and your flesh is saying, "Where is the God?" Like the question our brother asked, the Bible says when you give your tithe, God will open the floodgate of heaven. So our brother is saying, why is it that paying tithe, paying, the floodgates are not being opened? These are the issues of life. And that is what this presentation is meant to deal with. That as Christian leaders, we must not allow our faith and our commitment to shrink in the face of life's difficulties. That's the focus of this presentation. And it's a direct message of encouragement to those of you who are leaders here. And it is also a message that you will also take from here to the leaders of our churches, to the leaders of our associations, to the leaders of our conferences. Because those of you who are here, you are representing other leaders. You will go from here and take the message to other leaders. The truth is that we are living at a difficult time. The times we are living in, they are very tough. They are difficult. When you listen to the news, you read newspaper, you go to social media, the things you are hearing, the things you are seeing, they actually show that we are living at difficult times. And it is in the midst of the difficulties of the time that God has chosen us as leaders. As a pastor, I just imagine talking about the insurgency. I just imagine pastoral ministry in that environment. How tough. Last year, January like this, when we were in Jalingo for the General Workers Conference, I met, you know, some pastors I interviewed for ordination. Some of these pastors, whose churches were actually affected by the insurgent. And one of them said he was to go back to his home state. But four of their converts, people that converted from the other side, they said to them, said, when we see you, as we look at you, we are seeing God. Pastor, so once you leave us, we don't know what will happen to our faith. So the pastor said, oh God, I will stay. Take care of me. Leadership amidst difficulty of life. Leadership at such time. That's the time that God has called you to become a leader. When we were in the seminary, there was a course. We were on a pastoral care and counseling practicum class. And the professor was teaching us about grief. And there are some people that will die in a church, and it will shake the church. And our lecturer was telling us that at such a time, everybody's eyes on the pastor. Everybody's looking at the pastor, whether the pastor is going to say to us that all is over, or we can see continue. So no matter how close the dead person is close, the pastor, no matter how painful the loss is to the pastor, see, the situation would demand that. What you preach that, oh, a Christian does not truly die. A Christian, you know, he has eternity with God. For me, to all the quotation we quote in the Bible, that is the time for the pastor to prove it. If only he comes to the pulpit on Sunday and he said, before he will say a word, he has broken into tears. And before you know, the whole church. Christian leadership. Difficult times. As I look at the theme of the convention this year, is highly inspired. Because I see many people are actually struggling with issues. And issues of life, they generate questions. People are asking questions. But as it was exposed to us by the president, that we didn't even, sometimes we even forget that Jesus Christ has even told us that in this world you will find what? Tribulation. Tribulation. But be of good cheer, because I overcome the world. One of my thinking as a pastor is that since Jesus Christ said he has already overcome, it shows that even all the troubles I will go through in life, they are already decided in my favor. That is my mindset. In other words, before you even meet the trouble at all, know that God has said your victory is established. That is my mindset. And as Christian leaders, such mindset will help us to face the situations of life as they come. I want us to reflect on Christian leaders. What does it entail? In our setting, when I see people struggling to be associational moderator, people struggling to be conference president, people struggle to be convention president, to be director, to be this and that, there are some questions that come to my mind. Do people really know what it entails to be a Christian leader? That question actually came very strong when I handled some situation with some dickies. You know, like all the presenters have said, that difficulties of life, challenges of life, they come in different ways. And everybody is exposed to challenges, to difficulties of life. But how do you see it and how do you respond to it? That is what matters. As a Christian, two people can go to experience the same problem, but their own response to it can be different. I cite two examples. Two dickies, they had the same experience of marriage without children. Marriage without children. This dickie is married for many years and not gotten a child. This deacon is married for many years, has not gotten a child. And the one of them said he has gone, himself and his wife, they have gone to hospitals, they have conducted tests. If it is prayer, they have prayed. People have prayed with them, they have fasted, and they have decided to leave it in the hand of God and continue their life. So that was their result. We have handed it over to who? To God. So when you see that Dickie and his wife, every day their passion is how to live their life to serve God. Anything you put into the hand of that Dickie, he will do it thoroughly. And this other Dickie, just one day he just said, don't call me Dickie again. Don't call me Dickie again. And not knowing that he has already gotten into another relationship with another woman. So he just told people, don't call me Dickie again, call me brother this and that. When I heard about it, I have to travel from Warri to Port Harcourt. And I went to his house. My bro, what am I hearing? He said, I can't remember the exact year he was quoting. Well, 40 or 40, I'm 45 now. Even if I have a child today, by the time I'm 60 years, that child will be 15 years. Which time will I train him? Which time will I do this? So, So we talked. He did not listen. I now mobilized all the other dickies that they were ordained the same time. So this time around, we invited him from Port Harcourt to Warri, and all the dickies, everybody. So he just stood up in that meeting and said, "I knew before I came, I knew what all of you would say, but I've made up my mind." And he packed out of his matrimonial home. He left the wife, he left everything, he only took his clothes. The building, his personal building, he left it for the wife, left everything. And so you can see that, yes, it is a difficult situation for somebody to be married and there are no children, especially in this South African context. It's a serious matter. But see the way two different people who are Christian leaders approached it. So it makes me to think, what do people think about Christian leadership? How do they become Christian leaders? How do you become a deacon? How do you become a pastor? The goal of leadership, I was first of all looking at the goal of leadership. Then I said, okay, let me first look at the goal of the church. The goal of the church is to worship God, to the church, to make disciples, to represent God in character and deeds, and above all, to prepare humanity for eternity with God. That's what I see as the goal of the church. So, Christian leaders, they are people, instrument in the hand of God to make the church to fulfill her goal. The goal of worshiping God, the goal of being Christ's ambassadors, that is representatives of God in this world, to be able to prepare humanity for eternity with God. So this is the goal of Christian leadership. So if you are a Sunday school teacher, I want you to know that as a Sunday school teacher, your goal is to serve as an instrument in the hand of God to make people to worship God in spirit and in truth, to make people to live as God's true representative, to make people to be able to live a holy life, and also to prepare people for eternity with God. So, if this is the goal of Christian leadership, then I ask myself, how are leaders made? How are they produced? And that also took me back to Jesus Christ, how he himself made his own leaders. So the first issue about how Christian leaders are made is response to the call of God to salvation. In John chapter 1, verse 11 says that he came to his own and they do not receive him. And in verse 12, he said, those who received him, he gave them the power, the right, the authority to become the sons of God. So they are called into salvation. They are called into sonship. They have become children of God. And then after you have been saved, after you have been called into salvation, the next thing is submission to Christian discipleship. Submission to Christian discipleship. I was looking at the call of the disciples in Matthew chapter 4 from verse 18, where Jesus said, come, follow me and I will make you. That word is important to me. Make. To make. So Christian leaders are people that have been made by him. There is a making. And I ask myself, how did Jesus make them? How did he? So the form of, he took them through the, what we call now discipleship. The word of God was uppermost in the process of making. And I was looking at how Jesus Christ made the disciples to become leaders. Day by day he was teaching them. The kingdom of God is like, he used what he was familiar in the environment. He was like a farmer going to farm. He was throwing the seed. Some fell on the thorn. Some fell on the rock. Some fell on this. Those that fell on the good ground, they grew, they bear fruit. And he started interpreting it. Oh, the kingdom of God is like a fisherman who threw the net, and the net caught this and that, and he selected the fish, and all the debris he threw away. The kingdom. So, if you are a pastor here, give attention to the kingdom parables of Jesus Christ. In fact, every leader, because they are teaching us about the principles of the kingdom, the key issues about the kingdom. And once you understand them, you will see Christianity as different from the ordinary life on earth here. And that is key to overcoming life challenges. If a Christian leader cannot perceive life differently from the ordinary person, then something is wrong. You must see life differently from the angle of God, from the perspective of God. You must get to that point where your life will no longer be after what will I eat, what will I drink. A Christian leader should be able to see life differently. And where you can get that kind of understanding is in the Word of God, the kingdom parables. And then apart from the kingdom parables, Jesus Christ also spent time to teach them what we call the I am sayings. I am the bread of life. When I was studying the I am sayings of Jesus Christ, nobody, no Christian leader will understand the I am sayings of Jesus and you still be afraid of, if the church does not pay the scheme of service. If you understand these teachings, you will not be talking about the scheme of service. I did not know what is the scheme of service until recently. When people are asking me questions, that I need to answer them. So I have to study the scheme of service to be able to answer people. All my pastoral life, I don't know what is in the scheme of service. Because after I studied the I am sayings of Jesus, oh my God, I was seeing Jesus Christ saying to me that if it is food, I am food for you. When he said, I am the bread of life. I am the bread of life. He said, if it is food, I am food. That was my own conclusion. So by the time Jesus Christ took the disciples through all of these teachings, then gradually, he took them to the level of stewardship. He was teaching them. There was a time he commissioned them. You go out. Go and preach. When they came back, they were giving a report. We saw Satan falling. We saw your power. Somebody said, you have not seen anything yet. In other words, as you have been discipled, you will now graduate to the level of being a steward. And as a steward, you see his power, the efficacy of his word. It begins to manifest. That was how the Lord himself made his own leaders. And they began to assume responsibilities. So if you as a leader, you have gone through all this process, you'll be able to stand in times of difficulties. Let me just mention some difficulties of life that people face today, like sickness, poverty, delays. As one of our pastors, I had opportunity of praying with him and his wife, though that woman is late now. The woman was bedridden for 20 years. In fact, sometimes we cannot understand God. And God gave special gift to this pastor. The gift of revelation. If that pastor tells you something, if you joke with it, it will happen. And he also had the gift of healing. People come to testify. I was terribly sick. I went to hospital. Doctor said it. The test said it. I met pastor, prayed. I was healed. For one day he asked me, said, sometimes I feel embarrassed when people are sharing this testimony because somebody will surely ask, why is pastor not able to pray for his own wife? Can we question God? We can't understand it. But should the ministry of that pastor end there? So, these are the challenges. Poverty. Like I was telling somebody a few days ago, what I wanted to do for my wife. She will, in March, she will be 50 years. And I saw where they are selling new, brand new cars. I said, this kind of motor, I would have given it to my wife as her golden birthday gift. So somebody said, VP, buy it for her now. I said, the spirit is willing, but the pocket is weak. So, Christian leaders, there are times there are so many beautiful things that you want to do. This last December, I committed a sin. And I had to confess it. Because those of us working at the Baptist building, there was no salary. There was no Christmas allowance. So we went for Christmas, no money. And people were just coming. This one will come, hey, Oga, I need money. Oga, I need money. It's very difficult when a convention leader like me tell you that I don't have money. People don't believe, oh. So, the church where I worship on Christmas day, they gave me a bag of rice. So I told my wife that anybody that come, you can measure a bucket. Bucket measure for them, but cash. And this man came and he was trying to present the problem so that he can convince me. I said, there is no way I can be convinced. I'm already convinced. No money. Take rice and go. He said, Oga, you just allow me to land. You need to know. I was getting angry. No matter how you embellish it, there's no money. Take rice and go. So the way I talked, my wife, when he left, my wife said, I didn't do well, that I was angry. I said, I'm telling him there's no money. He's still presenting it. He said, you would have kept quiet. Poverty can be a real issue to Christian leaders. One evangelist said, anointing without money is annoyance. So the Lord will deliver us from annoyance in Jesus' name. Sometimes we suffer from exploitation. Some people will just exploit us. And those people are so big that you are not able to face them. You oppress us. Barrenness, warfare, battle, death, and bereavement. Sometimes it's irresponsible children. Pastor, your child not going to join secret court. Yesterday night, my wife called me. We have one of our pastors, he was one of my associate pastors. This woman is a teacher of holiness. Teacher of holiness. And for the first time, their son entered the university. Bowen University. First semester. Yesterday night, my wife called me that the boy took somebody's ATM and went to ATM to withdraw money. I was highly disturbed because I don't know how this pastor can withstand it. I don't know. It's going to affect her so much. So it's a big challenge. We don't pray to have a bad child, though. And sometimes it is not because, oh, you are the best parent. You are the champion of how to raise children. Sometimes it's not like that, though. It can be real through an attack of the devil just to frustrate your life and ministry. But leaders who are in such situations, the Lord will deliver them. Amen. So these are real issues that Christian leaders are facing. Now, how do we cope with them? Should the ministry die because of these challenges? That is the crux of this presentation. How do you do ministry or your own assignment in the church as a leader in the midst of these challenges? And some of the things that can help us to cope, they are the things we want to mention now. Number one is for us to know that Jesus is the owner of our life. You need to know that Jesus is what? The owner of your life. So, when issues get to a level where you have done what you should do, leave it in his hand. Leave it in his hand. So it's not for you to begin to talk, to abuse God, or to say things that you make you offend God. It's not for you to resign from your position, or for you to withdraw, or to fall by the wayside. Because this Christian race, by the grace of God, will run it to an end. And the crown of life will be our portion. We also need to understand the ability of Jesus to deliver us from difficulty. As I look at the scripture, I see how he delivered temporarily and how he delivered eternally. There is this temporary deliverance, there is eternal deliverance. Temporarily, in the sense that When Peter was in prison, the church prayed. He was to be executed. But because of God's intervention, he was released. Is that not so? But how did Peter finally die? Anybody know? How did he finally die? He was still crucified. So, to me, the deliverance in Acts chapter 12 was temporary. Because God still have some things for him. He still needs to, he has to fulfill his assignment. And then, at the end of life's journey, he was killed. And Jesus, the Bible says, do not be afraid of those who can kill the body without having anything, any authority over the soul. And this is where I want to thank God. Christians all over the world, where the insurgents are really, I have seen so many videos where people's heads were cut off. They put knife and cut the head. And these people remain Christians. I am for Jesus. I pray that their blood will turn the whole world to Jesus. Amen. Their blood will turn the whole world to Jesus. Amen. Like Saul of Tarsus, those who persecute the church, they will use their money to rebuild the churches that they burn down. So shall it be in the mighty name of Jesus. Let's continue to hold on to Jesus as leaders. He has the capacity, the ability to deliver. Also, Christian leaders receive strength from the Word of God. The Word of God is power. The time is gone, so I'm just mentioning some of these things. The Word of God, let us hold on to it. Christian leaders receive assurances in the place of prayer. Our sister dwells so much about prayer, even the president also dwell on that. Assurances in the place of prayer. I love what the three Hebrew men, they said. See, bow down to the graven image, you'll be set free. He said, we want you to know, O king, concerning this matter, there is no debate. The God that we serve is able to deliver us. Even if he decides, this is what we Christians, we need to know, that the way God answers prayer is different. Like he said to Paul, my grace is sufficient for you. Saul, whose handkerchief was healing people, he himself had an issue. Take this away. God said, no, my grace is what? Is sufficient for you. Leave it there. So the three Hebrew men said, even God, if God decides not to deliver us, we want you to know that we will not bow down to your graven image. So Christian leaders, let us draw inspiration from that. Christian leaders also receive encouragement from past heroes of faith. If you read Hebrews chapter 11, Hebrews chapter 11 gives us the history of the people of faith. You see? So if somebody tells me, oh, I've been a pastor, I am married, I have no child, Abraham. Abraham, for many years, he had no child. He didn't affect his service to God. Look at Zechariah. He was on his normal priestly duty. He had no child. But the angel appeared and said, ah, you are going to God, get the child. He looked at himself. He's an old man, the wife, an old woman. Ah, he said, what kind of joke is this? What kind of joke? He said, all right. Because you doubt, it will happen. But your mouth is sealed. I cannot question God, though. If not, I would have said that, ah, you should have pity on the old man. Why should he seal his mouth? The humanly speaking, the man was talking like a human being. How will you tell a woman that's approaching 100 years to go and carry pregnancy? But God is using it to teach us lessons. That with him, all things are what? Possible. To me, these things that are written in the word of God, they are for us. Those of us who are Christian leaders today, they are for us. So we must draw inspiration from the word of God and not mess up our calling as a result of the challenges of life. We are also empowered by the hope of eternity. As a student of history, I saw how people, the church from inception has been a persecuted community. We were born, the church was born into the world that was saturated by religions. And so Christianity was seen to be a kind of rebel group. The Roman Empire, Caesar is Lord. So you say Jesus is Lord, you are rebelling against Caesar. And it has continued. But what was it that gave the ability, the strength for the Christians to be able to stand and for this Christian faith to be spreading in the midst of persecution? The hope of eternity. The hope of eternity. Sometimes when a Christian is killed, there is this bishop that was killed, Polycarp. When he was given opportunity to just deny Christ and you spare. Old man, respect your age. We will set you free. But deny Christ, you'll be a free man. Polycarp said, 86 years I've been with Jesus. He has only done good to me. He has never done any bad. How can I deny him? You can do your worst. After they killed him, his death made people to think, this man is not a foolish person. This man is not a nonentity. He's in correct health. So if he had opportunity to stay alive, just to deny Jesus, and he refused to deny Jesus, there is something about this Jesus. We must look for it. The souls he won by his death was more than the people he won when he was preaching. Hallelujah. What do you think made a man of 86 years to stand and say, kill me, let me go home? The hope of eternity. The hope of eternity. And that should encourage those of us who are Christian leaders today. Oh, thank you, sir. You have done well. The hope of eternity. Christian leaders should also stand on the promises of God. Stand up. Stand what? On the promises of God. And the another one, live by faith and not by fear. Live by faith. A Christian lives by faith and not by fear. The time that their marriage, at that time, I will be rounding up now. Africa was regarded as the white man's grave. Because ordinary tsetse fly, mosquito, were sending them to their graves. I was reading the history of a missionary. When they were commissioned in America, the wife of the missionary had a friend. That night, before they would start their journey, the friend came, embraced her. Oh, you are going to Africa. Oh, my friend, we have heard so much about Africa. The Lord will be with you. We are praying for you. We are supporting you. We are doing this. They embraced. And then they traveled down. Here in Nigeria, the woman died. And the message reached the friend in America that the friend had died. She said she's going to continue from where her friend stopped. I was touched. If you hear that place, your friend just got there, few weeks, mosquito, she died. And you too, you say you are doing what? You are going there. What was the thing that gave them that kind of boldness and spirit? It is faith. Faith will carry us through in the name of Jesus. Conclusion is that the times are hard, but our God remains God. We belong to him, and we must remain true to him. More than before, we need to know that we are not of this world. Let us draw closer to God through his word, in worship, in prayer, and stewardship. Christians need to be more united against the onslaught of the devil. And I put a song. That song is in Urhobo language, but I tried to put the English translation. As you reflect on that, the Lord will grant us victory in the midst of life's challenges and difficulties, in Jesus' name. Amen.